I open to a random page. The corner is folded down like a bookmark. I clear my throat and start to read. Our clothes were long gone. I couldn't keep my hands off her. Every inch of her body called out to me. Oh!
Heavens!
Oh no! I found Elias's dirty books! Oh no!
This game contains content might not be suitable for most audiences. Viewer's discretion is advised.
Hello everyone and welcome back to the Groom of Gallagher Mansion. Today we are going to be finishing off from where we left off last time, and hopefully if we have the time, we're going to be going down Elias Gallagher's route. So if you haven't seen the last episode of this, I highly encourage you guys to go ahead and watch it. It should be up with my recent videos, but in case you guys can find it, there's a link up here as well as in the description. However, I'd like to remind you guys that this game is for adults only, so minors do not interact. And there's another thing I'd like to let you guys know, and that is the Groom of Gallagher Mansion is actually part of this year's Queer Halloween Stories bundle. Get over 100 amazing games, books, and audio dramas for the low, low price of $60. Honestly, I think that this bundle is great. There's a lot of amazing titles out there. And personally for me, I love the idea of being able to support a lot of these amazing indie creators. And heck, you guys know, of all people, like, I am a major fan of indie video games. And I would love to give all these creators like all the love that they deserve. But anyway, without further ado, let's get right into it, shall we?
Now then, shall we? It is time to show you my precious family jewels.
I don't want to see your precious family jewels. No. Elias and I make our way up the staircase as I softly grip his ethereal arm. I watch as his free hand grips the dark mahogany railing. The stairs creak, a little too loud. Leaning closer to Elias, my hold on him tightens.
Do not fret, my dear. These stairs are safe as long as you stay by my side.
Yeah, I give him an uncertain smile. Try not to remember the state of the decrepit stairs when I first entered the mansion. They now look elegant, lined with soft, gold-trimmed carpeting.
Careful now.
Elias places his hand atop mine as we walk down the hallway. He wears a faint, complacent smile. Is it tiring? Making the mansion... I posh. Not sure how I should rephrase the question. Not all of it is exactly hospitable.
You mean making it look like a ghost of its former glory?
Honestly, that is so freaking charming. He chuckles at his little pun. With a gentle pat on my hand, he sighs.
Admittedly, yes. It's quite tiring. But if it makes you comfortable, then I shall keep doing it. It also brings back many memories.
The smile on his face drifts into wistfulness. For a moment, he looks almost sad. I regret bringing it up. My grip on his arm loosens and I give him a smile back. Yeah, I think you've done an excellent job, Elias. With everything.
I appreciate your kind words, my dear.
He leads me to a door, then opens it. Inside is a bedroom similar to the one I awoke in, elegant and ornate, if not a bit barren.
Just a moment, my dear.
He lets go of my arm, making his way to the vanity. Still reaching for one of the drawers, he presses his hand against the wall, causing the vanity to lower and reveal a hidden compartment. I knew this mansion had at least one secret passage. Elias sifts through the drawers inside the compartment, eventually pulling out an unassuming dark wooden box. He slowly opens it, revealing a ring, a necklace, a pair of earrings.
Ah, here we are then.
My eyes light up with wonder as the jewelry sparkles, even without any light shining on it. The ring is a gold band with a large diamond at the center, a beautiful classic for a reason. Just the sheer size of the diamond alone catches the eye. Meanwhile, the necklace is a string of pearls with a ruby amulet on it, and so very dazzling to gaze upon, it's like looking at the very definition of opulence. And lastly, the earrings are a drop pair, with a Victorian love knot at the base with an opal centerpiece, and a yellow-tinted green sapphire at the bottom.
Do not hesitate, dear. Choose whichever your heart desires.
They're all so gorgeous. I can't possibly choose. Nevertheless, I reach out, gravitating towards the Honestly, I think the necklace catches my attention the most, so... The necklace. The necklace is heavy in my hands as I gently pick it up. Boy, bet I could pay off all my student loans and then some with this thing. I study it closer. It looks almost familiar.
Do you like it?
I do, but I think I've seen this before. Maybe from an old picture? Elias tilts his head.
It was one of my mother's favorite pieces in this collection. It's also the most expensive.
As he says this, it suddenly becomes even more heavy in my hands.
Here, allow me.
Elias takes the necklace and moves behind me. Could you tell me more about yourself, Elias? I'm curious to know as much as I can about my groom.
Of course.
His hands are cold against my skin as he slides the jewelry around my neck. He clasps it shut, hand lingering for a moment on my skin. He gives a tired sigh before speaking, a hint of melancholy lingering on his lips.
I must confess that I was born quite sickly, and my birth came with so many complications that it nearly killed my mother. Even after that ordeal, there was nothing the doctors could do to help my weak constitution. I suppose that's why my father and siblings treated me the way they did. I was seen as a nuisance, a problem. I don't entirely blame them.
I'm sorry.
It's far away and in the past now, so enough about that.
Elias moves back around to look at me, a cold ghostly hand trailing across my cheek. The sadness from his voice has all but disappeared.
Marvelous. The necklace fits you perfectly.
I angle my head up to get a clear view of it in the mirror. It certainly is gorgeous, but I know that I can get more information out of Elias if I play my cards right. I'm certain this necklace must bestow infinite beauty upon its wearer. Surely you've seen others don it before.
As I mentioned, this was my mother's favorite piece. It graced her neck quite frequently.
And what of your previous bride-to-be? Did she not wear this as well?
My previous bride.
The smile slips from his lips, and his eyes go hazy. I brace myself for another vision. I feel bad. I know it's unpleasant for Elias as much as it is for me, but he's a key witness to the mystery of this matter. His whole life and death, as a matter of fact. The silence stretches on for what feels like forever. Elias' face is completely blank, devoid of any emotion. Elias, dearest, I meant no offense. Elias grips my shoulders, his fingers phasing through my skin, causing a shiver.
Her name was Violet, Violet DuPont, the sister of our groundskeeper. We never wed because she betrayed me the day before our wedding. I suppose she and Gerard were desperate. I should have been on my guard when they continued to ask me about the location of the family jewels day after day.
I mean, they could have just they could have just asked a bit more politely. I'm pretty sure you would have obliged.
I thought the necklace, the grandest piece in the collection, would have been enough to hold her interest. I had promised to share the rest of them with her after our consummation. But before I could even cry out for help, Gerard held me down while Violet...
I put my hand over Elias's and I attempt to show him that I don't need to hear anything else. Forgive me, Elias. We don't need to speak of her anymore. Elias's grip on my shoulders ease and he gives me a sad smile.
No, you needn't apologize whatsoever. There's no need for me to reminisce, and you shouldn't have to compare yourself to her.
Well, yeah, I don't want to be compared to your murderer.
At least that's what I like to say. And I want to stop. I need to know the truth straight from the horse's mouth. Tell me about the things that brought joy to your life. You have a fine eye for beauty, Elias. I'm sure there were other items you held precious and dear.
You've seen the greenhouse already. So you can imagine its splendor in full bloom. I quite liked reading on the bench there when my energy permitted. It was quite difficult to visit in a consistent manner, however. So I often had flowers brought up so that I could enjoy the fragrant floral bouquets in the comfort of my room.
Elias leaves my side momentarily to grab an ornate box from the vanity.
Aside from the flowers, there was also a family heirloom that belonged to my grandmother. It was an antique silver mirror, and a very charming one at that. At least.
I lean forward as he opens the box,
and I peer into its contents.
What? That was before it shattered.
In the box sit several shards of glass, reflecting jagged images of Elias and myself.
I liked it quite a lot, and ended up taking it out of the attic in my early childhood. I used to look into it and imagine myself as some sort of fair prince. It was innocent daydreaming, but alas, my six older siblings would often mock my love of the mirror. And with such a weak constitution and gentle demeanor, there was little I could do. When six people who aren't very fond of you get physical, well, you can imagine what might happen. The mirror was shattered, and I was the one blamed.
He gently closes the box and pauses.
Grandmother didn't seem to mind that it broke, but I cried for days. Maybe it was sentimentality, guilt, or fear. But whatever the case, I simply could not let it go. I forbade any of the maids or butlers to toss out the shards. The mirror was meant to be a wedding gift, and I was determined to have it fixed one day.
It seems like that day never came.
Yes. It was one of my greatest regrets when I died, silly as it sounds.
The world needs more men like you, Elias. I don't think you're silly for having emotions.
Thank you for understanding, my dear.
The melancholy atmosphere in the room fades as he smiles warmly at me.
I am quite eager for our union. I think it'll be something glorious. I've always wanted a grand wedding, and to think I'll be marrying someone as lovely as you.
Well, you aren't too kind, Elias.
Come, follow me outside. I have much to show you.
We exit his bedroom together and go down the stairs one last time, my new accessory adding weight to my every step.
Soon we shall be wed, my darling, and we'll have all of eternity together. Are you excited?
Elias sure seems to be. I know how to answer that, but I should be sincere and tell him the truth or continue the charade. I spend the whole night here, but I have more questions than I have answers. So many loose ends, no way to tie them. And yet, I'm about to tie the knot with a man I barely know. Well, I have no idea if the other one will reach me in time. I'm so screwed.
My love, what's on your mind?
Nothing. I really am a bad actor in the end. With everything that has happened, is about to happen, I must be feeling the entire range of human emotion right now. My beloved, nervous, excited. And so full of dread. We return to the foyer, where this whole night began. Elias glides along the floor while I do my best to keep up with him, trying not to arouse suspicion. He places his hand on the door behind the steps, then turns to me.
Are you ready, my love? I have worked tirelessly to prepare the old ballroom for a ceremony, and while we may not have any guests, I do hope that you will be pleased.
My voice is so hoarse, so the words get lost in my throat. All I can do is smile and nod.
Excellent. Then without further ado...
The doors to the ballroom open wide, and Elias bids me through. I walk down the tattered red carpet, through the dim cavernous room towards the center, where extravagant dishes, aged bottle of wine, crystal glasses, silver cutlery, and finally, our bouquet awaits us. No one is watching, and yet with each step I take, I hear the echoes of whispers, murmurs, cheers, and sobs whenever my foot lifts from the floor. These memories of previous weddings Elias has attended, now recreated for his own. I wonder who will officiate. Elias must have some memory of a minister ready as well. I turn my head back and peer at the door, waiting for my groom. As he floats in, the noise grows more raucous, and the lights bloom with a pale blue glow. My gaze is fixed on Elias. An eternity passes in a single second as he reaches the altar, beaming with endless pride. It's time. The crowd hushes down to a murmur before coalescing into a single echoing voice.
Welcome all.
What?
Family and friends, thank you all for coming today to partake in this joyous occasion. Today we are gathered together to unite Elias Gallagher with his beloved.
I still couldn't take my eyes off my groom.
Long has he suffered, and now long shall he be overflowing with joy.
Oh, he'll be overflowing indeed.
Let the memories of betrayal, of murder, of waiting, be washed away like leaves in a flood. Love has triumphed.
Oh God, if this is what Elias is thinking.
Do you, Elias Gallagher, take this person to be your lawfully wedded spouse, to live together in matrimony, to love them, comfort them, honor and keep them?
This voice actor sounds very familiar, by the way.
In sickness and in health, in sorrow and in joy, to have and to hold, from this day forward, now and for all time?
I do.
Do you, my dear, take Elias Gallagher to be your lawfully wedded husband, to live together in matrimony, to love him, comfort him, honor and keep him, in sickness and in health, in sorrow and in joy, to have and to hold, from this day forward, now and for all time?
Stop!
Taylor, what? The slamming of ancient doors against the wall drown out all memories in the ballroom, and the illusions disappear without a trace.
Taylor!
Aside from the angry echoing of footsteps, there's only me, Elias, and a very, very sweaty Taylor in this otherwise empty sanctuary. Yeah, I've never been so happy to smell his attempts to mask the scent of sweat and overpowering cheap cologne.
That's right! This has to stop! You should have told Elias the truth ages ago. I should have told you the truth ages ago.
What do you mean, Taylor?
My dear, is this the spirit medium you were talking to?
It is. His name is Taylor. Taylor Potts, and...
Taylor. Why do you interrupt our ceremony? Speak now or forever hold your peace.
Elias's eyes flash with frustration.
Oh, have I got some words for you, Gallagher. All of this?
Why does Elias look so done? Taylor gestures wildly around the empty floor and tables.
All of this is for nothing! This was a dumb attempt to find a ghost, and now I've put my best friend in extreme danger. They didn't actually believe anyone was here. In my heart, I didn't believe it either. I was desperate. But we did our homework and read that you were obsessed with romance. The idea of it, at least. They aren't actually in love with you and have never been engaged to anyone before this. We went shopping for fancy clothes to trick you into appearing.
That is cruel, Taylor.
So stop all of this. We're too young for marriage. We're both just college students, for goodness sake. We have our whole lives ahead of us.
Taylor's arm drops to his side as he takes in a shaky breath.
Elias, you should be mad at me. I set them up to do all this. But I should have been the one here, not you.
Wait. This is reading to me as if, like, Taylor wants to be wed to Elias. Like, God damn it. I can already see all the fanfic of, like, people, like, shipping Taylor and Elias. Like, God, is that around in this game? Is that around in this game? Because here's the thing. I know the creators of this game have definitely read and made plenty of fanfics before. I look between both of the men standing in front of me. Taylor is out of breath while Elias can't find a word. He's disappearing! No!
I think we should let OHSIC disband. We need to go home. It's over.
What? But... Taylor, don't make decisions for me.
My dear is right. They have been perfectly able to choose what they like. I provided plenty of opportunities and...
Yeah, and they were playing you.
What? Taylor's previous fervor gets a second wind at the sound of Elias's voice, and he puffs his chest.
Our goal was to prove you exist. Now we have, and I regret it.
Taylor.
Besides, do you even realize what rushing into marriage does to people? What if it turns out that you two don't even like each other, or can't even stand being in the same room tomorrow? I don't know about you, Elias. There's only so many tabloids that we can salvage all the way back from, like, 100 years ago. But have you ever had to watch your parents fight with each other behind closed doors?
He's got a point. Elias cocks a brow in confusion. All I can do is stand there and listen, trembling.
Rushed, unhappy marriages lead to divorce. Maybe your parents got along fine. Maybe they didn't. But if this was a regular wedding between you and Bud, you'd be waving a red flag for the whole state to see.
Oh no, Taylor has a point!
Mom and Dad tried so hard to pretend things were okay when I was growing up. But I wasn't stupid. I saw the exhaustion on their faces. I heard what they said to each other. No one deserves that.
I'm sorry, Taylor. I didn't...
Besides, after all this, I realized... I'm jealous!
I'm sorry!
Oh, all this time.
Jealous of who?
Me, I assume. There's a rival suitor vying for your affections.
It's true. I think you're great, and I really, really like you. I've wanted to tell you that for some time. Since about the day we met, to be honest. But you were such a good friend. A kind friend who supported me in everything I did. I was scared to lose that. I was scared to make everything too big. But I guess I found a different way to make everything too big tonight, huh?
What a charming and sad story, Taylor.
Much to my surprise, Elias's voice drips with empathy. His words are genuine.
Elias, you're...
How could I not be moved? But, my dear, I need you to tell me the truth. What did you come here for?
I came here to help Taylor find a ghost. Our ghost hunting group was in danger of closing, and we decided to investigate this place. We knew people broke into this place pretty often, and no one ever actually claimed to see any ghosts, so we decided to do what we could to make you appear. Nothing I told you about the previous weddings was true. I wasn't left at the altar. I was never even at an altar. I'm just an ordinary university student trying to help a friend.
I see.
There it is. The truth is that. I suppose it had to happen sometime. If Elias could sink into the center of the earth, he probably would. The only thing keeping him afloat is some sense of decorum.
But not all of this was a lie, was it? Your demeanor changed as we spent time together. You got to know me. You learned about the real me. And I think your heart opened.
That is true.
Oh no, come on, don't do this. I get that you're lonely, but you're completely missing the point here.
Taylor, please. Where we go from here is up to them to decide.
What?
The lights are flickering. The world is collapsing and nothing makes any sense anymore.
I don't know what to do. I should never have come here at all. This whole thing was a mistake.
Both Elias and Taylor look away from me.
So that is it then? It simply ends with nothing?
What? A tear culminates in the corner of his eyes before rolling down his cheek. Not nothing.
Let's just go and forget this happened.
What? What was that?
That came from above us!
What? Oh no!
It's over.
Elias?
Run!
I can't. My feet are frozen. I couldn't move at all.
With Elias in so much distress, he can't focus his energy on maintaining the building anymore. We crush his hopes and dreams. Decades of waiting, all for an empty lie. I feel Taylor tackle me in an attempt to escape, but it's too late. My head should be spinning. Imagine I've been out for hours, but I feel fine. Like nothing's happened. Cautiously, I move my hand out into the darkness and find nothing. Even though I should find something. Oh no. I hold my hand up to my face in the darkness, and I can see right through them. Like they aren't there to begin with.
Hey! Hey! Someone help me!
Taylor's panicked voice rings out in the gloom. Taylor, are you...
Something's wrong! I can't feel my limbs!
Taylor, I think... She got caught in the rubble too?
Yeah, but... Oh! Oh, shit! Fuck!
Yeah... I think we're dead. Go, Taylor!
It's true. Sorry that the mansion couldn't hold you. I did warn you about that rickety second floor. A few times, in fact.
What triggered the second floor to collapse? Elias floats between us, an indiscernible look on his face. He almost seems happy?
And as you also know, it has been close to a century since the estate has seen proper maintenance. Who do you think ensured that the facade and the outer gardens kept well and proper? You entered at your own risk.
How did you maintain all of this?
And now, I think we'll all be together for some time. I cannot tell you how excited I am to have some company at long last. In fact, I didn't expect your souls to stay in this world. But I suppose that you two have some lingering regrets anchoring you to this place, same as me.
Whoa, hang on.
Elias, we never meant to...
Leave if you want to try, but don't expect to get very far. I strongly suggest that we all learn to like each other very quickly, instead of letting this situation fester.
There's no hope for us?
I never said that. Personally, I was never able to leave the mansion even after my death, much to my own chagrin. So I doubt you will have much more success.
But I welcome you to your new life. Or should I say death? Enjoy it for what it is.
His little pleb face! Oh my god. Taylor and I exchange glances, then look back at our new host. I can't tell if Elias has lost it or if he's making more sense now than ever. Well, guess we're ghost roomies! Several months later. It's taken some time, but I finally managed to get my soul to climb high enough to return to the bedroom. I didn't think moving would be so hard. Elias made it look so easy. Taylor still hasn't quite figured it out. Maybe it's despair. Maybe it's Elias helping me more than him.
I thought you might return here.
Oh, Elias.
It's a nice little bedroom, isn't it? If you want to lie down, go ahead. No reason not to relax, even for the dead. While you rest, I'll go talk to Taylor. I think it's high time things changed around here.
Wait, changed how?
For the better, I hope. Wait here.
What? And with his signature bow, Elias is gone. I take his offer and lie my soul down on the bed. It's as soft as I remember. I can't help but fall into a deep, long sleep.
Wake up, dear.
Yeah, come on!
What? I open my eyes, stretch my limbs, and look towards my morning greeters. Taylor and Elias float nearby, hand in hand!
So, we decided to start dating, and we'd like you to join us.
Ghost Molecule? Really? I couldn't help but wonder what kind of conversation or how many conversations they'd had while I was out.
We both have feelings for you, and maybe you still have feelings for the two of us. What do you say? Want to try it out?
Yes!
How about it? We can repair the ballroom if the three of us work together, and we can spend the rest of eternity dancing in each other's arms.
Will you marry us?
How can I say no? Sure, what the heck? After all, if death hasn't done us pot... Nothing ever will. I do. Ending D. Forever. How is it that the neutral ending is perhaps one of the best endings I have seen out of a horror visual novel in a long time? I am sorry? Okay, so right now we're gonna be going down Elias's route. So the first choice of matters would be the rose. And since we've already seen this, we are gonna be skipping ahead. And the second choice I need to go for will be to find Elias's bedroom. So let's head up there.
I exit the dining room and head towards some stairs on the side of the foyer. If I remember right, Elias Gallagher lived a solitary and mostly sedentary life inside this manor. If he was put on bed rest for the majority of his time here, chances are that he'd stash personal valuables in his bedroom for easy access. I don't know where his room would be, but I get the feeling it's upstairs. Either way, we're about to find out.
And what are you planning to do? Reenact the BJ scene from Ghostbusters?
The what scene?
I laugh, shaking my head.
You're the one who wrote those type of scenes in that notebook I found in the club room.
Taylor starts to stutter as he tries to come up with an excuse.
That? I never. How did you even?
I try not to break out in laughter, for fear that Elias might hear me.
That notebook contains highly classified information, I'll have you know, and I do not appreciate the invasion of my privacy.
You're the one who left it open.
Still, I... Never mind. Forget it.
Oh, the store is slightly ajar. Guess I'll go in. I swing the door completely open, wincing as the hinges creak. It's another bedroom.
What's wrong?
The layout is the same, but it almost looks sad. I take this moment to look at what's in front of me. In the center is a bed that's perfectly made. Fluffy pillows donned in silk covers sit upon a thick comforter. My hand runs over the plush fabric as I walk up to the bedside table. There's a few books here, but overall, this room is almost barren compared to the one I woke up in.
I'm actually not too surprised. There were 7 kids, and the heads of the household after all, so it wouldn't be unusual for the bedrooms to look the same.
I guess that's fair. I catch a glimpse of something on the vanity and head over to it. Hey, there's an ornate box on the vanity. Surely something like this has to contain something important in it, right?
Be careful! We don't know if that's spring-loaded with some kind of trap!
I don't think it will be, but... I hold my breath and take off the lid slowly. Glass shards. That's it.
Seriously? Why waste such a neat box like that on trash?
Maybe it's something important.
Kinda doubt it.
I slide the lid back onto the box and look around the rest of the bedroom. There's a bookshelf in the corner I hadn't noticed when I walked in. Guess what? There's not a bookshelf in here. Guess it must actually be Elias's bedroom after all.
What's on it?
Seems to all be fiction. Jane Eyre, Persuasion, Sentimental Education, The Portrait of a Lady. The click of the keyboard is comforting as Taylor lets out a chuckle.
Those are all romance novels.
My fingers gently brush over the well-worn spines. It looks like they've been read countless times. Not only did he lack familial love, it looked like Elias didn't have any platonic or romantic love either. He was stuck here. Only had a fantasy world to live in.
Don't feel too bad for him. We can't change what his life was like, no matter how sad it is. It's already over.
The least I can provide is solace. Make his afterlife a little more enjoyable. Less lonely.
Don't fall for his act.
I scoff slightly.
Act? What act? Elias has not once shown any hostility or invasiveness. He doesn't have any malicious intent.
But what if he tries to possess you? Didn't he...
Taylor, I appreciate your concern and I care about you a lot, but accusing Elias of something like that without any evidence, especially considering how he died, is unreasonable. You're being paranoid.
The line is silent. For a moment, I think he may have hung up on me, but his quiet voice finally breaks the silence.
I'm sorry.
He sounds upset. It elicits a soft sigh from me, my whole demeanor softening. I apologize if I sounded harsh. Elias just deserves someone too, you know. He's all alone.
I'm just really worried about you, bud. You're alone in there.
Don't worry, Taylor. If I were truly in danger, I'd have asked you to come save me by now. Taylor's voice sounds less upset as he speaks.
Yeah, of course. You're right.
My love, are you here?
Shoot! Elias is coming!
He is? Can you hide or something?
Yeah, I'm trying.
Elias appears before me the moment I turn towards the doorway.
What are you doing in here, my dear?
Hey, fancy seeing you in your own goddamn bedroom, Elias. Oh, what are you doing here? I am not decent right now. The door was open, and I noticed quite a few books on the shelves.
So I wanted to see if the recipe might be in here. I pull out a random book, a smile on my face. You have quite a taste after all, Mr. Elias Gallagher. My grin widens as Elias blushes. I love the ghost boy!
What? Is he getting embarrassed over there?
I read it for the plot. It's actually quite good.
Oh my god, wait, are you sure it's just for the plot? I'm pretty sure it's for the same reason some people read, well, certain books for the plot.
Really? Let's see. I open to a random page. The corner is folded down like a bookmark. I clear my throat and start to read.
Our clothes were long gone. I couldn't keep my hands off her. Every inch of her body called out to me. Oh!
Heavens!
Oh no! I found Elias's dirty books! Oh no! Elias covers his face, bending over from embarrassment. I could hear Taylor having a laughing fit in the earpiece. Ignoring my own embarrassment, I put the book away and comfort Elias. However, half-heartedly. My apologies. It's quite all right that you divulge in all types of literature.
I should have hidden those books better when you were asleep. I'm so sorry you had to see that.
It's fine. It is fine. I mean, it's fine. Most people are interested in adult fun times. Are you all right, my dear?
Elias lets out a groan and peeks at me through his hands. He then slowly straightens, finding it hard to look at me in the eye.
Yes. I just find the subject of physical intimacy to be rather difficult to talk about.
Oh, don't tell me the guy's a prude! He's freaking obsessed with marriage! What does he expect married allosexual people to do?
Everyone in the Victorian era was a prude, Taylor!
Did you say something?
I clear my throat loudly while Taylor sighs on the other line.
What I said was, were you never close to anyone before you met me?
Elias plays nervously with his fingers, fascinated with the decor of his room instead of me.
Have you ever kissed anyone?
No! I was never really thought of as attractive to anyone.
How did you are such a catch, Elias Gallagher! Hold on! You not attractive? You're kidding, right?
Elias shrinks further into himself.
Elias, you're one of the most handsome men I've ever met. I'm serious, the things I love to do to you.
The what you do to who?
Taylor, chill. This is my moment, not your moment. Chill out, Taylor. You're a ghost in an alternate timeline. I am dying. Oh no, maybe I was too forward with that.
Darling, I'm quite flattered by your compliments, but I have my reasons for being inexperienced. Well, beyond simply never having been properly wed before, of course.
What sort of things strike your fancy? I'm sure you'll perform well in the bedroom. I'll guide you through it. What sort of things strike your fancy?
Elias stops fidgeting as he calms down.
Oh, plenty of things. Like the flowers from earlier, reading books, writing, drinking tea. The list can go on and on, really.
Holy shit! He's so innocent! This is hilarious!
It's so freaking funny! I don't want to hit Taylor so bad right now, but I can't really reach through my earpiece and strangle him from here, so I bite the inside of my mouth.
That's lovely, dear, but I meant your interest in a more intimate sense.
Intimate? Oh, heavens. This really isn't something to discuss out of wedlock.
It's fine! Elias, it's fine! Like, I'll guide you through just how I'd love for you to hold my hand.
Please, I'm really only interested in satisfying my partner. Now, may we please return to the wedding preparations?
Why, yes, of course. In fact, I'm not gonna let you, like, get away with this. I'm going back and see what the other interactions were like.
I'm sure you'll perform well in the bedroom, Elias. After all, you're looking forward to what comes after the wedding ceremony, aren't you?
What the hell kind of comment is that?
Taylor, shut up!
I am. The consummation of our marriage, that is.
Elias looks around nervously before puffing out his chest in mock bravado or some semblance of it.
My strength and will is ever stronger after death, so I will do my best.
Your nose is bleeding! What are you even imagining right now? Oh my god!
Lovely. That's quite the spirit now. Hey, I had to deal with your shenanigans, Taylor. It's my turn to put you through my shenanigans.
Anyhow, it would be in our best interest to move forward with the preparations. If you may, please follow me.
Sure thing. In fact, let's go back and screw with you even more. I will guide you through it.
I'll guide you through, my dear Elias. It's nothing to be ashamed of, at least in this day and age.
Oh, is it?
All right, I'm tuning this out. Tell me when it's over.
Oh god, I'm pretty sure like Taylor is a stand-in for the audience at this point. I am so sorry all of you have to sit through me flirting like incessantly with Elias Gallagher. Holy frick.
It's not uncommon for one to explore themselves in solitude. How familiar are you with your own pleasure?
I not very well, admittedly.
If you like, we can explore together.
I will consider it.
He clears his throat, trying to regain his composure.
Well, I did find the cake recipes. Would you care to join me back down on the ground floor?
Why, yes, of course. He floats out of the room and I follow him out to the foot of the stairs.
I initially came to find you so I could ask what flavor of cake you would like. Have you decided?
Yeah, that's right. Let me think. We walk back to the first floor hallways as I ponder my options. Yeah, we're still gonna go with Earl Grey since that's his favorite. All right, I'm gonna be
excellent
skipping
choice. You have the most wonderful taste, my dear.
Yeah, I know. I have amazing taste. That's why y'all are here on this channel. But we are gonna be skipping ahead.
I still can't believe you managed to find his smut collection.
Oh, believe it, Frick. I am so glad no one's found my smut collection. I didn't mean to. I swear, I just picked up a book at random.
I would have loved to see the look on his face. Though you really didn't have to ask him his favorite sex position afterwards.
Hey! It was already awkward, so I kind of just wanted to see what would happen, you know? I end up laughing a bit too, despite myself. Anyway, I wonder why he had a box full of mirror shards. It just seemed so out of place in his room.
I couldn't tell you anything about it. Maybe the dude's just a weirdo.
Huh. I don't think he's like that.
Are you seriously starting to feel something for Elias? Because I'm starting to think he's casting some kind of magic on you to make you feel connected to him.
What? Nah, no way. What did he... I don't know, man. Like, I'm not a psychic.
Honestly, and I mean it this time, I want you to leave this place.
Okay, fine. We're gonna skip ahead to, like, the last option. So for this last option, we're gonna be choosing the ring, because apparently that's the one that Elias likes the most. I pick up the ring and inspect it closer. The name Gallagher is engraved in the inner band with fancy cursive lettering. Elias gently takes it from me and slips it over my finger. It slides uneasily, without being too loose or too tight.
A perfect fit. Like it was made for you.
Like you were made for me? It's quite gorgeous. Is there some kind of story behind this ring?
A bright smile blooms on Elias's face as he kisses my hand, the diamond sparkling on my finger.
My grandfather held a high post as a military officer, being the personal guard to several members of the royal family in England. He was humble and full of wit, and thus could predict the enemy's movements far in advance. Why, during his time, he actually thwarted an assassination attempt!
That is hella cool. Eyes widen. Oh my, it's quite the life he must have lived.
Indeed. They offered him a gift for stopping the attempted regicide. The deed to a gem mine. It was quite successful, and on top of that, he managed to increase the productivity quite a bit. That's how he himself rose to aristocracy.
Elias' smile softens, eyes sparkling as he regales the tale.
When a civil war broke out, he fled to America with my grandmother, my father, and only a few belongings. It wasn't quite enough to maintain their previous lifestyle, at least not immediately. Yet regardless of how much they struggled, he still refused to sell the jewels. They represented everything he had been through, his dedication and hope despite the hardships. That determination inspired my father to start a business of his own. Eventually, he became a commio baron beyond compare.
Well, I mean, I guess like different achievements like kinda inspire people in different ways. Elias lets out an awkward chuckle, looking away in embarrassment.
I suppose I pale in relation. I never amounted to anything when compared to the great deeds my grandfather, father, and siblings accomplished in their lifetimes.
Nonsense! I squeeze his hand compassionately. You grew up kind, dear Elias. Hopeful and determined, just like your grandfather. It doesn't matter that it didn't apply to business. It certainly applied to your heart.
My dear.
Elias looks past me, biting his lip.
I must confess something to you. I doubt that it will affect you now, but...
I brace myself. I have no idea what he plans to tell me.
I adore you, but my mere existence is a blight. My polite mannerisms and lavish clothing are merely a thin veneer over the fact that I am weak, hideous, and undeserving of my status.
Elias, don't say such awful things about yourself. You never had the tools to succeed in a world that measures your worth by your productivity. Without even considering the barriers that hold you back, you were thrown into the meat grinder without emotional support or physical ability to meet the challenges head on. I take a breath to steady myself. This system was not made with people like you in mind. So how could you expect to succeed when you are pitted against people who don't face the same struggles? Despite that past neglect, you've always been hopeful. That is far more admirable in my eyes.
You are far too kind. I appreciate your words greatly, however.
Elias grips me tighter, as if afraid I might run off.
The truth is, I was congenitally malformed.
Malformed? I took another look at Elias, squinting. At a glance, I could see nothing amiss. He seemed to have all of his limbs, fingers, ears, eyes, and nose. His clothing betrayed no alteration in form or function.
It's not immediately apparent, thanks to years of learning to adapt around my condition, but it's true. My feet are malformed, were malformed at birth, and so in life. I had difficulty walking. Compounding that was a general sense of malaise that never improved over time.
Elias pauses, gaze never leaving mine, yet looking past me all the same.
The family doctor had diagnosed the malaise as what was commonly known as a nervous disorder at the time, a condition which had then only recently been christened as multiple sclerosis. Being that both my congenital deformity and acquired nervous disorder are incurable, my continued existence proved to be a great burden that only grew over time.
I'm so sorry. My apology feels so inadequate. I don't know what else to say. What am I even apologizing for? My gaze turns to the side as I think of something better to say. On its own, being ill is nothing to be sorry for. It's not within anyone's control, but when the systems and people that you have provided support fail a person with an incurable condition, it truly is regrettable. Elias was confined to bed, even though the condition itself could have been managed with proper support. Because his siblings had never needed that kind of support, that alone was enough to condemn Elias to an isolated life of hardship.
My birth itself was difficult,
and caused my mother quite a lot of grief. I don't blame her for any resentment left over from that. But it wasn't all bad. I consider it a blessing that my condition could be easily obscured, so I wouldn't bring further shame to the family name.
We both glanced down to where his feet would otherwise be, and replaced by a ghostly, translucent tail.
Tell me, several decades have passed since my death. Surely both science and medicine have marched forward during that time. Are there cures now for the conditions I had in life? I hate to consider that anyone may still be suffering from these afflictions.
I'm afraid that doctors still haven't found a cure for multiple sclerosis. We know a lot more about it now, though. Some think it's an autoimmune disorder, and we can manage the symptoms. Some researchers even believe they pinpointed the cause, though that is still to be seen. And then, surgeons can provide prosthetics. Artificial limbs, that is. Vast strides have been made for prosthetics since the Great War. It's an option if people can afford it. I managed a genuine smile at him. There are whole practices dedicated to learning how to live with and use a new limb, fitting prosthetics for individual patients, therapies for regaining physical strength and social integration. There is so much to be hopeful for now. Elias closes his eyes, bowing his head.
I see. That is a small comfort, I suppose.
Being disabled does not make your life something to be ashamed of, Elias. You did the best you could with what you had, and I still intend to wed you, my dear. Elias takes in a breath, regaining his composure while loosening the grip on my hand.
Let us dispel such unpleasantness now. Shall we take our leave for the ceremony?
I do my best to nod and smile, the weight of his words still heavy on my heart, my arm wraps around his. We shall. We exit his bedroom together and go down the stairs one last time, my new accessory adding weight to my every step.
Soon we shall be wed, my darling, and we'll have all of eternity together. Are you excited?
Elias sure seems to be. I don't know how to answer that, whether I should be sincere and tell him the truth or continue the charade. At the very least, I can confidently say that there's no way Elias is capable of expressing malice towards others. He's too sweet, too naive almost. Elias deserved better, deserves better, but I'm not the one he deserves. These feelings I have for him can only be described as pity. I can't love him the way he wants me to, the way he needs me to. Not today, at least. It's too soon for me to mean those three words he desperately needs to hear. An insincere declaration of love to Elias Gallagher will surely be a sin worse than murder.
My love, what's on your mind?
Nothing. I mean, I really am a bad actor in the end. Everything that has happened is about to happen. Must be feeling the entire range of human emotions right now, my beloved. Nervous, excited, and so full of dread. We're gonna skip ahead, by the way. Thank you, Elias, for giving me a choice. I ask for your forgiveness. I can't say that I didn't mean to deceive you, but I regret it. Also, I don't regret meeting you. I only wish it could have been under better circumstances.
I can't say that it doesn't hurt. I'm not sure if I will ever see you in the same way again. And yet, I am glad we met as well. This day, it was perhaps the best day of my life and death. I hate that it must end this way.
Must it? You were also correct when you said I got to truly know you, and you've been nothing but kind and loving towards me this whole time. I do want to be with you, Elias.
What?
If you'll still have me.
I
could never comprehend the thousands of emotions that must be beating through Elias's heart. Taylor has tried to say something, but I can't hear him.
My love, I want our happiness to thrive. Will you learn to love me in joy and despair until the end of time and beyond?
I will. I do. I'm trying not to stumble over my words, but I think I managed to choke them out correctly.
Then we are wed.
Elias takes my hand, fingers tracing the ring he slipped on my finger. He holds me close. He kisses my lips, and I nearly faint again. But once his kiss is over, I'm awake, alive, staring deeply into my husband's eyes.
It is done, my love. Now, shall we elope on our honeymoon?
Where are we even going?
Taylor, my dear medium, I ask you to help us see the world.
Taylor, it's so awkward!
We can revolutionize your ghost club. We can change humanity.
Elias helps us?
And I know my love appreciates all that you've done for them.
It's true. I turn to face Taylor, who's extremely interested in the floor all of a sudden, a crimson blush tingling his cheeks. Taylor, maybe I would have dated you if you had asked me. I think it's too late now. But you've always been a good friend, and I have always cherished you. If I didn't, I'd never have come to this mansion.
I shouldn't have said anything.
No, you should have. You care for me so much. I love you, Taylor. I hope you can understand how. I put a hand on his shoulder and lean in to give him a peck on the cheek. But I want to love Elias Gallagher too, and I'm ready to spend the rest of my life with him.
I don't want to be a third wheel. I'll go.
Taylor, no! You're not. You know what? You and Elias, in an hour, we're getting to know each other. I'll take some time to myself. I could use a break.
You're gonna change the world, Taylor. I just know it. I wave to them both and step out the ballroom. Wow. I kissed a ghost and married a ghost, found love with a ghost. And not 12 hours ago, I thought I was getting all gussied up for nothing. I rub Elias's ring, enjoying its embrace on my finger. It shines in a dim light, as if it were a candle. So, do I own this mansion now? Or partly own it? I guess so. We'll have to start thinking about repairs. This isn't the world. This doesn't have to be the world. I walk through the halls, down the foyer, and step right out the front door. And the world is ready to greet me. I'm ready to greet it. The morning sun is beginning to peek over the horizon. I watch it with contentment as it climbs into the sky, ready to light up the world around it. Soon, Elias and Taylor find me waiting for them outside. Everything hashed out?
Hashed?
Yeah, we've gotten to know each other. And we've come up with an idea.
Are you both still gonna be together?
Yes. I'm not particularly excited by the prospect of becoming a freak show to gawk at. But my flowers, those are another thing.
Ready to start a spectral florist shop?
A what? Oh, absolutely!
What shall we call it? Gallagher's Spectral Exotic Flowers and Bouquets?
Hey, I get to have my name in there too. We're business partners now, after all.
I let the two boys bicker and rest my head on Elias's ethereal shoulder. It's gonna take some adjustment, but I can't help feeling as though everything is as it should be. Ending B. For love.
Anyway, that's all for this episode of the Groom of Gallagher Mansion. Thank you so much for watching. If you guys do want to get this game for yourself, link to the game will be in the description below. And if you want to get this game on top of like 100 other games like books and audio dramas, again, the Queer Halloween Stories Bundle is on sale throughout the month of October. So be sure to grab that while you still can. But in the meantime, I will be coming back for another episode of this where we go through the last two endings and maybe the extra scene at the very end of the game, but you're going to subscribe to know when that's going to be coming out. But anyway, thank you all so much for watching. I hope you all have a lovely rest of the day. And as always, I'll be seeing you in the next video. This is Lion, signing off. Ciao.